pleasant. Currently works at UBS, the world's largest wealth management firm, and was recently promoted and now oversees a team of analysts and consultants. In the near future, Jorge plans to attend law school and hopes to become a corporate attorney. His goal is to serve underrepresented communities in a pro bono capacity. Please join me in welcoming LGJ alum Jorge Mejia to the podium.
Yo, yo, how are you? Hey, everyone. So yeah, I promise to not make this formal in any capacity because, you know, I was in your seats too, and the last thing I wanted to hear was someone ramble about how, you know, like how sad they were being back in here. But you know, I do have something for Enzo, you know, like let me not put those long hours to waste. Hi, everyone. Good evening and happy Wednesday and happy convocation. First and foremost, I'd like to thank Ms. Guillem, who, this is the camera, okay, who I know is joining us via Zoom. For the honor of addressing you all on this very special day. And to all LGJ teachers and staff, I just want to say thank you also for continuing to nurture the academic village that raised me for over 6 years. And to all students here whom I have the privilege of speaking to, congratulations on your convocation and upcoming graduation. This is a very big deal, and you guys should know. So, 7 years ago, I was sitting in the audience just like you all, and trust me, the last thing, again, I wanted to hear was how nostalgic and teary-eyed a 20-something-year-old was, you know, felt being back here. Because it was 5 p.m., I was hungry after a long day of class, I just wanted to get my pin and skedaddle, so trust me, I feel you. So, let me start off first by saying what I'm not going to do before launching into the bulk of this talk. I'm not going to bore you. I promise that over the next few minutes, I'll do my best to equip and empower you with useful insights that I wish I had known when I was in your shoes. I'm not going to regurgitate outworn feel-good quotes like follow your dreams, try your best, etc. Because to be honest, you can probably hear that on TikTok. But also because the reality is life is messy and quite unpredictable, and you know that better than most people. You've spent 4 years in high school, half of those years coinciding with a life-altering pandemic. Most of you likely feel demotivated after 2 years of virtual learning, new ways of working, and of adapting to a way of life that only your classmates can fully relate to. That aside, let me tell you what I will do. I hope to reframe and redefine the way some of you may be thinking of this major moment in your lives, which right now probably just seems like a small blip in the cosmic timeline. I'm going to highlight three mental frameworks, or what I'm going to call here on out paradigm shifts, that have changed the way that I think about my life and career as a former college student and currently as a young professional in the financial sector. And to keep things practical and ground level, I'm going to sprinkle in some examples of how I myself have incorporated these shifts into my own life and how I use it to navigate the real world. So the first of these paradigm shifts is captured poetically in a quote by the famous nonfiction author and keynote speaker, Stephen R. Covey, that says, "Live your life by a compass, not a clock." And I'd like to flesh out with you guys what that means in this current context. So you've probably been asked at some point, you know, what do you want to be when you grow up? You're likely being asked a variation of that question right now, right? What major do you want to do? Well, I'd like us all to ponder a slightly modified and far more complex question than that, which is, how do you want to live your life? Notice the distinction here. What is an outcome, an end state, a point in time? How is a process, a system of behaviors, a set of guiding principles? What falsely implies that life is to be lived according to a clock? When, for example, do you want to be a doctor or a lawyer? How, on the other hand, advises us to live according to a value-driven compass? So the question changes from when do you want to be a doctor to in what career, occupation, or capacity do you envision yourself expressing the values or causes that are dearest to you? This clock mindset says, okay, 4 years of college, then 2 years of master's, then dream job, right? Easy, linear, predictable. For me, I thought that meant 4 years of college, then 1 year of work in finance to pay off my student loans, then law school, then boom, big bougie lawyer. But it's turned out to be far more complicated than that. Yes, it was 4 years of college, but instead, 3 years of post-grad work, 6 months of reflection, introspection, and questioning about whether or not I truly wanted to be a lawyer or if that was just like a bandwagon opinion that I had, and only then applying to law school. The clock mindset is far too neat and clear to handle the ambiguities of real life. In contrast, consider the compass mindset. The compass mindset asks, what principles drive you, and how can you express those principles in your day-to-day life? At your job, in school, in your community, and at home. For example, do you enjoy tech? Then maybe express that passion as a data scientist or a software engineer. Do you like teaching? Then perhaps live out that calling as a professor or a teacher. Do you love solving complex problems? Maybe exude that interest as a lawyer or a judge. See, it all starts with the inner why, and only then does it become a tangible job. For me, the compass mindset is, how can I drive social impact with the power of law? Maybe I'll start by being a corporate attorney at a midtown law firm, supporting underserved communities in a pro bono capacity. Maybe that means being a lawyer at a public interest law firm. Or who knows, maybe be a legal counsel at an impact-driven venture capital fund. The options are endless because my compass doesn't predefine my destination, it just gives me a sense of purpose and direction on the journey. So the clock to compass mindset is that first paradigm shift I want to leave you guys with. Sorry, because I don't have water, my lips are getting chatty, I'm sorry. But moving on to the second one, you've likely been asked, who's your role model? The idea being that it's always someone else, not you. I propose that you consider the possibility that maybe you can be your own biggest role model. Now, let me clarify exactly what I mean by that, because I don't want people to, twist my words. I'm not saying that there aren't successful people whose paths you should look up to. For me, it's Sonia Sotomayor, who is the first Hispanic justice of the Supreme Court. Nor am I saying that you shouldn't rely on mentors to guide you on best practices and common pitfalls. Nor am I saying that you shouldn't lean on family, teachers, and friends for support. These are all and will always remain indisputable facts. What I am saying, though, is that no one else can play the game of life for you except you. There's a quote by Rumi, a 13th century Persian poet, that says, "It's your road and your road alone. Others may walk it with you, but no one can walk it for you." And I think that communicates this idea perfectly. A brief example of what I mean, people can tell you where on your syllabus you can find your final exam date and when your professor's office hours are, right? But you have to decide when to start studying, how to study, with whom, and what kind of bond you're trying to build with your professor beyond just school-specific matters. The main takeaway here is be someone that your future self will be proud of. Make choices today that will position you to look back and be proud of the choices you made were your own versus following a social trend. Look back and be proud that you took the road less traveled rather than one that was easiest or most commonly followed. Look back and be proud that the toolkit you have, your skills, your experience, and your network are products of your tireless hustle and grind. In short, look back and inspire yourself, because in your worst days, and trust me, you're going to have really bad days. The one thing that will enable you to persist is a realization that I have gone through this before. For me, I chose to launch my career in finance rather than be a paralegal or work at a public official's office right out of college, even though that was the path of least resistance for someone wanting to go to law school one day. Investment banking was the most unfamiliar option to me, the scariest option, and the one that was the most outside of my comfort zone. But because of that, I knew it was the one path that promised maximum growth. Everyone on my team had prior experience at other banks and were significantly older than I was. So when I started out, I felt constantly challenged and pressured to outperform and be overprepared. Mediocrity was not an option. You guys have all probably heard the term imposter syndrome, right? This is just a slight variation on that. But in the end, because I was forced to thrive in discomfort, I became a subject matter expert in finance and proved to myself that I am capable of mastering any new professional environment that I might face. I'm now the youngest promoted associate on my team, so whenever I have a bad day or facing a challenge, I just gotta look back and humbly say, if I did that, then nothing's stopping me from doing this too. So that's the second paradigm shift. Don't only look beyond yourself to, but also look within yourself. Inspire yourself by being your own role model. Sorry, my lips are really chapped, so please not my baby. One second. Okay, I'm good. Slow down, guys. Slow down. Yo. All right. So the third and last point I'd like to make is being a trailblazer or being the first is in your DNA. Being the first to do something surely makes it harder, but it's also your unique talent, gift, and advantage. There's a quote by Elizabeth Blackwell, who's the first woman to receive a medical degree in the US, that goes as follows. It's not easy to be a pioneer, but oh, is it fascinating. I would not trade one moment, even the worst moment, for all the riches in the world. Statistically speaking, every single one of you is exceptional. Low income, inner city, incoming first-gen student, person of color raised in the Bronx. You have led challenging lives, and yet here you are today, about to be complicated, in a few weeks graduating from LGJ, and in a few months starting exciting journeys as young adults in college. No one can take that away from you. Society has made it systemically difficult for you to achieve these milestones, and yet here you are, showing up, never backing down, always getting the work done, pioneering. From here on out, you will be navigating spaces where not everyone will look like you or have grown up like you did. For me, I went to a college where virtually no one knew what Section 8 was or what food stamps were. Even today, I work at a company that manages $3 trillion in assets, where few understand or kind of don't even care about what having a 401k means for people like you and I, who were raised first-gen low-income. The further up the ladder I go and you all go, the reality is that fewer and fewer people will understand what it's like being first. And while that's unfortunate, it's also incredibly motivating, because the longer you and I trailblaze this path and comb through the forest, the more we make room for others to join us, so that one day you and I are no longer the exception, but the norm. So when you succeed in those rare spaces while still being your authentic self, you show other low-income first-gen students, LGJ grads who come after you, what is possible. You shatter any glass ceiling and empower students to dive into the unknown, destroy the very idea of impossibility, and charter their own paths. You inspire your friends, your family, people you don't even know, to be unapologetic in the pursuit of their goals. So whether you like it or not, you now lift as you climb. Trailblazing and being the first is in your DNA. Get used to it, because that's just who you are as LGJ champions of the charge, but also embrace it for the sake of empowering and impacting your community, peers, and society at large. So as you get your pin today and put on your cap and gown on June 24th, ask yourself, how will you live your life with a compass, not a clock? How will you be your own biggest role model? And how will you continue to trailblaze forever and always? Thank you.
Thank you for coming back home. Sorry we made you thirsty. Sorry. Thank you for coming back home to speak to the class of 22, our future alum. I wish you continued success and may your dreams come true, Jorge. At this time, I would like to announce, we are going to announce and recognize our valedictorian and our salutatorian for the class of 2022. I'm going to call Ms. McGee and Ms. Glass to the podium.
Good evening, everyone. A It really is an honor to present the salutatorian today. This year's salutatorian has been a student at the Bronx School of Law, Government, and Justice since the sixth grade. Yeah, she is a leader and a scholar. She has a genuineness about her that invites others into her circle. Her smile lights up a room, her warmth, humility, and kindness are contagious. She has completed the rigorous college application process and is currently deciding between Cornell University and Bates College. She has many interests and will explore law, medicine, and political science. And she said she hopes to find a career that gives her meaning and allows her to help her people and others in need. We cannot wait to see who she becomes in the future. The salutatorian of class 2022 is Benedict.
Valedictorian of his eighth grade class and continued to excel throughout high school. He is not only a scholar, but he is deeply passionate about service to others. He's willing to give up himself to help anyone who is in need, and he is a friend to all who need him. He is loyal, caring, and a wonderful young man. He is a role model to his peers and is respected by the staff and students alike. Lastly, his humility and leadership are unmatched. This fall, he earned one of the highest recognitions by receiving the Questbridge Scholarship to attend Yale University. We are so proud of him and all of his accomplishments. We are sure that he will continue to excel in life and wish him only success like we do all of you. It is my great honor to present the valedictorian of the class of 2022, Mr. Michael Sumner.
Thank you.
parents who are viewing us live stream, faculty and staff, please join me in congratulating once again our BAL and our SAL. We are so proud of what you have accomplished for our team here today. I now invite Mr. Hara to the podium.
Good evening, class of 2022, parents on our live stream, families, faculty, staff. The convocation pinning ceremony gives us the opportunity to recognize our remarkable senior class along with their families who have helped to guide them on their path to success. The convocation also provides the class of 2022 with an opportunity to reflect on our school's mission and the importance of carrying out the LGJ charge long after graduation. The charge is an acronym for, I'm gonna give a moment, pause, and I'm gonna say 1, 2, 3 just to see if you all still remember this after all these years. The charge is an acronym for 1, 2, 3. Jayla still got it. The charge is an acronym for collectively helping all realize greatness every day. Your teachers, counselors, and administrators hope that we have helped you to realize your greatness and are confident that you will continue to do so long after leaving LGJ. I'm very proud to say that this evening, all 100 of these students who are participating in the convocation ceremony are on track to graduate. They have worked very hard and are continuing to do so because they understand that is not over until we all get across that stage on June 24th. Seniors, we urge you to finish strong as we are now in the final marking period of your high school career. This is just the preview of your big celebration, which will be your graduation in June. Mrs. Glass, I'm gonna call you to the podium to begin our pinning ceremony.
At this time, I'm inviting the seniors to please rise. Seniors, please rise. Seniors, if you are ready to accept the responsibility of passing on the values and principles upon which LGJ was founded, please raise your right hand and say, I am.
I am.
Okay, at this time, I'm also going to ask our faculty and staff to please rise. And guys, this year we're gonna do it a little differently. We're going to repeat after me. So this is our faculty reciting a pledge to you. We charge you to solemnly pledge in the presence of this assembly
to do your best
to maintain high standards of learning behavior and commitment to your community
to recognize and thoughtfully respond
to the challenges ahead. To embrace the idea of success. And not limit your expectations of what you can accomplish. Again, seniors, if you are ready to accept the responsibilities embedded in the senior pledge that we just recited, please respond, I am.
I am.
I will now ask Ms. McGee and Mr. Sharp to come to the podium to share the meaning behind the pinning ceremony and the blue rose that you will receive today. Thank you. We may all be seated.
Seniors, in the next segment of our ceremony, we will pin our beloved 12th graders and present them as the graduating class of 2022. Seniors, by accepting the LGJ pledge and now receiving your pin, you are accepting the responsibility to uphold our LGJ charge values and being model seniors in the LGJ community by finishing strong. You will also receive a blue rose. Mr. Sharp will now explain the symbolism of the blue rose.
This blue rose symbolizes the school color as well as a person, a special person in your life who has helped you get to this moment and will help you to stay on track through graduation. After the ceremony, you can give your blue rose to that special person. That person may be a parent, a teacher, adoptive parent, etc. And again, congratulations on this great achievement. Faculty, please stand and prepare to pin our seniors.
When you are prompted by me, you will stand and proceed to be pinned by a faculty member. All faculty members standing before you have pins in their hands. May I please have the front row on this side, please rise. Please proceed to the faculty to receive your pin and then to the rose table.
Thank you.
All right, and 2020.
At this time, we would like to invite all the seniors to please join us for a class photo in the back by the in the bleachers. Also, don't go yet. After the class picture, this right here is going to turn into a photo booth, a photo backdrop. You can get pictures taken, right? And there's going to be some refreshments and pizza in the back. So at this time, should we go by row? All right, so let's go with the first row, first heading back to the bleachers. Second row right here.
DJ Kuzrani. Thank you. Everybody, party, everybody.